Three quarters of our fish stocks are being overfished, and things are getting worse. Some scientists are predicting disaster in the next 40 years if we don't act now. Even our politicians admit that Europe's fisheries policy is a mess.
We don't have time.
If we don't make changes, we will lose one fish stock after the other.
So 6 months ago, I decided to leave the comfort of River Cottage behind and go on a journey to find out what is really going on at the industrial end of our fisheries. And what I found out is that things are not just bad, they're mad.
I think I just saw 90%+ of all that beautiful fish go over the side, dead.
It's a damn disgrace.
I wanted to do something about it, but I knew I couldn't do much on my own.
And here on this beach today, we start a campaign. How many of you are going to get behind that campaign?
This is the story of how a huge number of you joined our Fish Fight campaign and of all the amazing and unexpected things that happened as a result.
The question is the motion on the order paper. As many as are of that opinion say aye.
I absolutely reiterate the massive congratulations are due to Tesco for a very bold decision.
And if we keep up the pressure...
Is anyone from John West here today?
Together, we could actually change European fishing policy before it's too late.
Hugh, firstly, for people who may not have seen the series, can you just recap briefly on what you set out to do with that program?
Sure. Well, I love fish. I think it's one of the greatest foods on our planet. I'd be surprised if there was anyone here who didn't love tucking into a really beautifully cooked piece of fresh fish. I love to catch it. I love to cook it. I love to eat it. I love to feed it to my family. And I love to serve it at our cookery school and on the menu in our restaurants. But I think we all have to face up to the fact that the future of fish is highly uncertain. And this is what I set out to look into in these series. And obviously we needed some sort of rationale for looking at this very major problem. So we took the three most popular fish in the UK, and it's a popularity that's reflected around the world, not necessarily the most popular in every country, but you'll recognize the names, cod, salmon, and tuna. One sea that was once abundant off our own shores, still fished there very heavily, but in a lot of trouble, stocks on the point of collapse, that's cod. Tuna, which we import from tropical waters all over the world, mainly tinned, and we then consume in vast quantities, the sandwich stalls all over the UK. And salmon, the great farmed fish of these North Atlantic waters, both here in Scandinavia and around the coast of Scotland. And we decided we had to get to the bottom of what were the fundamental sustainability problems of these three fish, and that would perhaps start to tell us where we were going wrong and how we might set off on a new footing to try and have a better relationship with fish. And the other thing that really motivated me was that people, marine biologists, ecologists, NGOs looking into these problems kept telling me that this is a fixable problem. It's one of the great fixable environmental problems we have. Climate change, that's a really, really tough one. Looking after the fish in the sea, so we take out only sustainable numbers, I'm not saying it's easy, but it's definitely doable. And the World Bank has actually calculated that if the sea's oceans were sustainably managed, carefully managed, so that the brood stocks were allowed to recover, we could, within a very short time, have a marine harvest worth $5 billion more than it is today. So the sea still has an incredible potential to feed us and contribute to our health and, of course, our happiness as satisfying our appetites for one of the... It is one of the foods for which I think, umami aside, we have a great appetite. And there's some really important evolutionary history in that. We are who we are because we learnt to eat fish. There's even one theory that we went through a semi-aquatic phase and lost the hair on our bodies because we spent so much time waist deep in water leaning over to pick out shellfish or spear fish. And it certainly accounts for the extraordinary development of our brains over a short period of time. And I think about that every time I feed fish to my kids. I wouldn't want to be in a world where I couldn't give them this wonderful, healthy food so packed with omega-3s. So we looked at all these problems. We looked at tuna and the way that supermarkets were mislabeling it and making bogus environmental claims about the methods being used. There were two biggest branded tins in the UK had a totally meaningless statement on them, which said, Tesco, or Prince's, two big brands, is fully committed to methods of fishing that protect the marine environment and its species. It's a sort of bogus and circular claim, particularly considering they were using purse seining and with a massive bycatch of sharks and juveniles, turtles, and other unwanted species. So we challenged them. We said, take that claim off your tin or start putting Poland line tuna in the tin. And they've made a commitment to, both of them have made a commitment to source at least half their tin tuna from Poland line fisheries by 2015. And that statement is no longer on either of those tins. The great European problem we decided to face up to is this crazy byproduct of CFP, Common Fisheries Policy legislation, which is the staggering amount of perfectly fine edible fish that is thrown over the sides of boats because it doesn't fit within the rigors of the quota system. And I knew about this, and it made me feel uneasy for a long time, as I think many chefs who had heard about discards felt the same way. But I had no idea of the scale. For example, I didn't know that over half the fish by number were being thrown back into the North Sea, trawled fish from the trawler fishery, amounting to over 500,000 tons of fish. Not all of it edible, but lots of what I saw going over the side, prime cod, cod like this, huge coley. On one haul alone, a boat I was on, threw over quota, coley, whiting, and cod over the side that I calculated would have fed 2,000 people. So, you know, 10 times as many as we are, nearly 10 times as many as we are here in that tent today from one haul of fish, didn't fit with the quota system, had to go over the side. So we went out there, got the shots, came back, put a show together, threw it out online with a great campaign for which I'm hugely indebted to a really talented team. And the response was extraordinary. By the end of the night of the transmission of the first program, we had over 200,000 signatures. And by the end of the series run, we had over 500,000. And we now have over 807,000 people signed up to the Fish Fight campaign, not just from the UK, but from all over Europe. And we've particularly launched the campaign in Spain and Poland and Germany and countries where we fight, where we really feel that there's a huge opportunity to raise consciousness on this issue. And it's still unresolved. 18 months later, we've got to the point where a discards ban has been proposed at the European level. It's survived a number of tough talking sessions in Brussels and Luxembourg, and it could become ratified legislation by November of this year. If we continue to push, that might happen. So I'm still hoping that some of you here today will feel interested enough and excited enough that you can do something about this problem to maybe have a look at our website, maybe sign up. A lot of you have your own followers on Twitter for your restaurants and the work that you do, and it would be great if you could give our campaign a bit of a shout, because we need to keep going all the way until we get over the line. So that's kind of where we are 18 months later. It's been extraordinary time for me. I had no idea what I was letting myself in for. Brussels and Luxembourg are not my favorite places to hang out. Anyone know any good restaurants? Anyway, anyone here from Brussels? Let me come and eat with you next time. So that was that's where we're at with the campaign.
So I want to take you back to the very start of filming, because I've read somewhere that you decided you wanted to do a series about fish. You hadn't completely narrowed it down to what the series became, but you said that once you had spent those first 24 hours on the Scottish trawler, it just became so apparent. And I just want to talk a little bit about the surprise that you felt after that first day? Because that surprise, that passion, that anger really comes across in your series.
It was an extraordinary 24 hours on this trawler out of Scrabster. It was just a regular fishing trip for these guys, and they were coming. I mean, we went out there knowing it was towards the end of the quota and that they would be grappling with the discards problem. And let me be very clear, fishermen hate throwing away fish. They go out to sea to bring back fish. It's a dangerous job. They do it out of a passion in many cases, out of a determination to be out there at sea and to bring back a food that they believe in. And the idea to them that they have to throw a lot of this away is anathema. And yet it's been part of their business for so long that it has, it's part of the whole system, so much so that the way the fish are processed on the boats is that the fish go along a conveyor belt inside the below decks where they're pulled out. Some species are gutted, some are put straight on ice. It just depends how the fish is going to go back to port. And basically, anything that isn't part of your quota catch or that you're not planning to land and sell just stays on that conveyor belt. You don't have to sort of agonize over, you don't have to put it in a bin, it just stays on the conveyor belt. And what's on the conveyor belt just drops out of the side of the boat and goes back into the sea. So on this particular, on these particular hauls where they'd finished their quota of cod, they were hoping to catch some haddock. They'd finished their quota of coley. They were after monks and brill and flatties, but it's a mixed fishery and you can't put signs on your net saying, no cod today, please. Sadly. So they were discarding a huge amount of fish, and but not really having to confront the issue of how much was going over the side. But I saw that they were picking out maybe one in every 10 or 20 fishes, and the rest was going over. And then on the next haul, my director had an idea. He said, let's just ask them to put all the fish that they would throw over the side into fish baskets instead of letting it go down the chute. So we stopped the chute, took all the fish that they weren't allowed to land into fish baskets, moved it along until they were, the fish from just one five-hour haul of, on one trawler, that's all it was, and we had these 24 baskets of beautiful prime fish, which we took up onto the deck and looked at, and I talked to the guys, and it made them see everything in a new light. You know, they hadn't had to confront the waste for so long. It had been automated waste. And for me, that was an incredibly intense moment. And I felt at that point we had a story for our documentary, and we also had the beginnings of a campaign, because I thought, who in their right mind could watch that fish being tipped over into the sea and think that that is a workable policy. It's a very complicated business, as choosing fish for a restaurant in a sustainable way. Almost impossible to get right all the time. But it's something we've been trying to engage with for a long time. And I think that everyone here has an opportunity to spread that sense of responsibility to all who they engage with food. And that's, I hope, one of the opportunities of these next couple of days is the amazing things that we're hearing and the amazing opportunities to share that and spread that.
Just in terms of that, Hugh, and we'll go to the audience after this this question, you've been working in the kind of vanguard of campaigns about food now for more than 10 years. Do you feel that the kind of feeling on the ground is changing, that more and more people are open to the ideas that you and other people are talking about? Because everybody knew about the European fish policy for the last 10, 20, 30 years. Nobody did anything about it.
I think there's a much, much greater awareness in the restaurant trade. The multinational companies the biggest fishmongers in Europe now are supermarkets, and they are the ones who have the biggest power. But in the end, supermarkets will listen to their customers. And some of the information that customers take when they go shopping to their supermarkets is from the food they've heard about, the chefs they admire, the cooking they like. That some of that does stick. And one of the most encouraging things I had the mind-blowingly wonderful experience on Friday night of sitting down at Noma and eating a lot of wild food, a lot of very carefully grown food. I didn't gorge on protein in that extraordinary number of courses and that massively diverse feast. We didn't pile through great chunks of meat and fish. We had delicate morsels, lovingly prepared, intensely put together with the kind of care that we've been hearing about so far all morning. And it was wonderful, and it made me think, this is possible. Right back to the first speaker today, Thor, told us there's a lot of wonderful food out there. We don't have to get monomaniacally obsessed with either protein or starch from just a few sources. We can spread our nets a little wider, and the burden on the earth can be a little less than it currently is. And I think that message is getting through. And I think we have a greater volume of ethically aware and sustainably aware consumers now than ever before. But fighting against that, we also have an expanding global population. But I think we're often told that the problem is not food availability, the problem is food distribution, and frankly also methods of production. And food sustainability ultimately is food ethics, because if we tear the world apart in pursuit of short profits from short-term investment crops, we are heading towards a massive crisis at some point. And it's so important that everyone who regards food as anything other than a fuel, and frankly even those who see it only as that, accept that there are massive changes that are needed now in food production across the world.
Okay, let's open it to questions from the audience. Can we get some lights on the... Yes, we can. And we've got a question up here. And a question in the middle after that.
It's actually one question with three parts. But what is better than the quota system? And should boats go out at shorter lengths of time? They're obviously fishing too much. And what do the authorities say, the governing bodies say in the UK, when you present to them the amount of fish that's being thrown overboard? What do they say to you?
Well, our fisheries minister in the UK, Richard Bennion, has been absolutely clear that he wants to see the elimination of discards. And I think most people would say elimination of discards or massive reduction of discards. You cannot claim to be conserving fish stocks if you are throwing 500,000 tons of good fish overboard. But you've raised the You've raised the question, how are we going to do it? And ending, banning discards without any thought to adjusting the quota system is going to cause a lot of problems, and we have to anticipate those problems and work with them. The main changes have to come from selectivity of gear and the way in which fish are targeted. Because at the moment, the system allows fishermen to catch anything and then land according to the quota system. So their motivation ultimately, and you know, financially times are very tough for these boats, so it's entirely understandable, is to come back with a hold full of maximum value fish. And this has led to crazy versions of discarding, for example, high grading, when you've still got cod quota left, and you're targeting cod and you're catching cod. But every cod below 3 kilos is being thrown back, because a cod of 3 kilos is worth slightly more in the market per kilo, quite a bit more, 50p to a pound more. The bigger the fish, the bigger the price per kilo. So there's a strong motivation for only catching the bigger fish. And that can mean that you're putting away 70, 80, 90% of the cod you catch, even when you've got cod quota. High grading, the high grading version of discards was made illegal in the North Sea I think 3 years ago now, or 2 years ago now. But it still happens every day because there is not the will for enforcement and there is the fear of bankruptcy on the part of fishermen working under that system. So we need a wholesale change of approach. And the first thing is to be much more successful at targeting the fish that we can land for a price. We don't want to transfer a problem of discards at sea into a problem of stinking, rotting discard fish on land. If we are going to bring in some over-quota fish, And I think it will be inevitable that that happens. We need to make sure it's not wasted, so that that is most marketable. I mean, Norway have done it. They have a version of this system. And the overquota fish that comes in is divided, it's a little more complicated this, but broadly into two categories. The least value fish go for fish meal. The more higher value edible fish, the fishermen are paid a handling fee, not enough to motivate them to want to catch that fish, but then that fish is distributed into non-competitive markets. It goes to schools and hospitals and things like that. So there are ways of doing this. And they all have their problems, and they will all have their critics. And there are many, many people who are pointing out the possible problematic consequences of implementing a discards ban. And I don't deny for a moment that there will be those problems. But I do deny absolutely that we have a right to take whatever we like out of the sea and throw away what we can't use, not because we can't use it, but because some crazy legislation that was cooked up in Brussels a couple of decades ago makes it obligatory to do that. That is not fish conservation, it never will be, and it'll never be sustainable, and it has to stop.
Okay, we... Okay, somebody had their hand up.
One thing I want to add to that. No. There are some extraordinary sustainable systems, and if you want to find out about one of them, Dan Barber, who's here talking later today, has done a fantastic TED talk about the fish he fell in love with and fell out of love with, and an amazing aquaculture system in Spain. So we have to embrace these solutions, but they have to be environmentally sound and ultimately built on ecosystems that will last. So it has to be an ecosystems-based approach, not simply a fish numbers approach. Sorry, okay. Back to your question. Yeah.
I'd like to first of all congratulate the speaker for his passion, and it's a wonderful approach. But two things. Has there been any change in the type of nets that are used when you have gone aboard these ships?
We've touched on gear changing. We could use that in both the metaphorical sense and the literal sense. The industry has done many very excellent pilots and demonstrations of the efficiency of using more selective gear in allowing a lot of bycatch or potential discards to escape the nets. But then they're not then obliged to follow up on that. And the process of piloting new gear has, to a degree, become window dressing for the industry. And it needs to now be properly embraced. And what we're hoping is that one of the chain effects of a discards ban will be that fishermen will be highly motivated not to bring in fish that they can't profit from. And that will actually provide the tipping point. But by goodness sake, and it needs some financial help with that. We know the EU is awash with money, and it spent some of it so badly in pursuit of so many misguided goals, including in the realms of fishery. But helping fishermen to gear up with more selective, ultimately more sustainable gear would be an incredibly good way to spend a few tens of millions of euros. And this is what has to happen. It has to be a supportive change for the industry. Because we all, as I said at the beginning, we all want to go on eating fish. It's such a fantastic food.
Well, we can, but there's one question that comes in all questions of conservation, and that is the stress of a sustainable population and a sustainable family.
Yep. It is stressful, it is difficult, it's a huge challenge, but we have to make some wholesale changes.
Okay, we've got a question down here towards the front.
In part, you already answered the question was about farming. Is farming part of the solution or of the problem? And the other one is about consumption. Should we pay more for fish?
Technically two questions, but we'll let you away with that.
Aquaculture has to be part of the solution, such as the demand for fish. It's here already. It's not going to go away. But of course, it's part of the problem because most of the species that we're farming need to be fed. They're carnivorous, and they need to be fed on fish. So we are actually feeding a lot of very fantastic edible fish to some fish that are ultimately easier to package and easier for the multinationals to sell. So we're turning millions of tons of Peruvian anchoveta into farmed salmon because people like to buy a boneless fillet in a cellophane pack, was again the theme of the earlier talk, instead of reaching out to discover with our appetites how wonderful and beautiful these little anchovies are. We're hoovering them up, desiccating them into powder, making them into pellets, and feeding them to other fish that one part of the food community finds easier to deal with because they don't like little fish with small bones. So that is a big cultural problem that needs to be addressed, and it's something that the Brits are probably most guilty of all. We like our fish to come in fat fillets, except when it's white bait, of course, which is horrendous from a sustainability point of view because it's actually the baby fish of a whole load of different pelagic species. Sprats, on the other hand, now that's an adult fish. Anchovies that size, that's an adult fish. And actually, these massive shoaling pelagic fish ultimately are the ones that have the capacity to feed great swathes of humanity on the planet if they're managed in a sustainable way. Mackerel, there's always a problem with loading onto a new species and giving that species the status of the hopeful sustainable alternative. Mackerel's a great and frustrating example. A couple of years ago, I was telling everyone we should all be eating more mackerel. We should be doing a mackerel fillet sandwich, hot mackerel fillet sandwich, lightly battered with some tartar sauce in a soft bap in every fish and chip shop in the UK. It's not because of that campaign that this has happened, but now, only a few months ago, the Marine Stewardship Council decided to withdraw their certification of Northeast Atlantic mackerel. Basically because the EU and Norway can't agree with Iceland and the Faroe Islands of how much of this extraordinary abundance of mackerel. If we could only restrict our appetite for Northeast Atlantic mackerel to a mere 650,000 tons a year, it would be sustainable. But no, we insist on taking out 750, 850, this year close to a million tons of mackerel. And that's pushing it over the edge.
We've got a special request from Rene, who wants to ask the last question to you. And I think under the circumstances, it would be rude not to allow Rene to do that.
So, Hugh, I would just like, you know, I'm a cook. I went to school. I learned, you know, the technique of a béarnaise. Nobody tells you about these things here. So, you know, do you think it's important for the cooks that they are the ones that sort of know these things and take part of this?
I do, Rene. I do, because we have an opportunity to, and therefore we must. It's as simple as that. And other people are not doing it as best they can. And I'm not saying it's the moral duty of every cook to bang on about sustainability on their menu at every opportunity. But it is an opportunity. And those of us who believe in the future of good cooking and the future of using wild food, I mean, we've talked about wild plants and the abundance out there. Fish are not farmed generally. The ones we're eating most of at the moment, they are wild, taken out of the sea. And there's a big issue in all our relationships with killing animals to provide food. And I see it as ultimately a kind of contract. It's not an original idea to me, but I've read about this and thought about this, and I think it's roughly right. In the same way that we have a contract of good husbandry for every farm animal we raise on this planet, which says, I will look after you when you're alive. I will feed you what you want to eat. I will give you even some bonuses. I'll give you excellent maternity care and try really hard to make sure your offspring don't die. When you're sick, I'll make you better. But most of all, I'll allow you to do what your instincts tell you you want to do the whole time you're on the planet. If I fulfill that obligation, maybe I can make a case for slaughtering you at an immature age and feeding you to my friends. But if I break that contract, then the deal is completely off. If I shut you up in a tiny barn and let you die of thirst, or let 10% of you die of thirst, or 10% of you die of a heart attack from obesity, or whatever the problems, particular problems of intensive farming mortality may be, maybe I've broken that deal. And I think we have a similar deal with the oceans, and it's to keep the oceans fundamentally healthy if we're going to continue to extract vast quantities of edible protein, also known as fish, also known as animals, from that sea.
Okay, I think you'll agree that Hugh has...
Thank you.
Okay.
I have one more question.
Oh, he's the boss.
And a quick answer. Will the world become more delicious as well?
I think everything tastes more delicious if you feel good about where it's come from. I think that is the true meaning of provenance, and it's why... it's why there are no longer any great chefs in the world who don't care about provenance. Those two things are now incompatible, and that is a very good thing.